slides and this unexpectedly small screen over here. And then some of the diagrams I'm going to be using might be a little bit not so well visible to be seen in the back row, I'm afraid. So there's like, if you think you want to change, there's still some seats over here, maybe you can change during the talk.
It doesn't work.
This didn't work, but you
okay, we can start, I believe. So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome at the last, but of course not least, plenary session of our conference. Today's speaker is a PhD student at the Jagiellonian University. He wrote his MA thesis in logic at the Jagiellonian University under the later on, he spent a year in Switzerland, in Geneva. He already wrote his PhD thesis, yes?
Practically.
Yes. Under the supervision of Professor Klatek at the Jagiellonian University. And he also spent 1 year in the United States at the University of California. He also asked me to mention that he likes criminal, a British criminal from the 70s, like The Saint and so on. So let me introduce Jacek Bakar, who will speak about talking about the open future. Jacek, how is
yours?
Thank you.
Thank you. That's for the criminals. So thanks for the very accurate description. So, first of all, let me thank the organizers. It's really great and very unexpected pleasure and honor to be here and talk here, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. Even though I had some reflection, so basically I'm very fond of this whole idea of philosophers really, and when I counted in my memory yesterday, I realized that the number of times I've been here is quickly approaching double digits already. So it's, I think next year it's going to be 10th time. If I come to here next year, and I think I will, it's going to be the 10th time during the rallies. I'm very fond of this initiative. I really like the last time the rally was in Lublin. It was really an amazing experience in 11 years ago, actually. And at that time, I was, first or the second student. And Piotr actually personally hosted me in his own family flat, so it was a really, really, really nice experience. Thanks again for that kindness. But then I started thinking, because I've been here again and again and again, so maybe there is the second layer to this invitation. So the organizer thought, well, this guy keeps coming here, he keeps bothering him. Maybe we should finally give him more than 20 minutes. Okay, so maybe finally he says what he wants to say once and for all and give us a break. Okay, so this is stop coming here. So if that was your intention, I'm afraid it's not going to have to work. So I warn you already. But let me begin. So my title of the talk is sort of only has two layers to it, because it's an accurate description of the talk itself as well as the subject of the talk. So I'm going to be, the two things are going to happen here. So I will be talking about the open future, and also I will be talking about the open future. So both the metaphysical or ontological and semantic or linguistic part of the issue of open future is interesting to me, and I'll mention both during the talk. So, it's gonna take a quick outline. So I'll talk about the open future in the framework, so-called framework of branching time or the branching structures. So describing this framework briefly at the very beginning and how I think we should think about it. Then I'll give you like state of art of the semantics of the open future debate, how people thought we should do semantics in this kind of setting, and then I'll try to introduce another idea in this branching setting, which is the idea of possibility that have been introduced already, but it met some problems, and I hope to get the actuality straight. So I hope to solve some problems. that this idea of actuality have met. So let me begin. Okay, it's a very brief introduction. So traditionally, like we inherited from antiquity, I believe, like two traditional models of time. On the one hand, there is a time as a circle when everything returns, everything recurs, everything happens again and again and again. And on the other hand, there's this idea of time as a line, as a linear series where events happen one after another, after another, after another. The second one, I guess, is more popular these days. And then, apparently sometime in the 20th century, a new idea pops in. So there's some origins might be found in writings of Charles Sanders Peirce and also by Henri Bergson. So both these guys had some idea which was explicitly stated in 1958 in a letter by Saul Kripke to Arthur Pryor. So Saul Kripke had just read Time and Modality, very important book by Arthur Pryor, and he actually found a few mistakes in his proofs and his theorems, and he said he wrote Pryor a letter saying, oh, I have this problem, you have these problems here, I have these suggestions, and also I have an idea. And he says the idea is stated here. Now, in the Terman system, we perhaps should not regard time as a linear series, as you have done. Given the present moment, there are several possibilities for what the next moment may be like. And for each possible next moment, there are several possibilities for the next moment after that. Thus, the situation takes the form not of a linear sequence, but of a tree. Okay, so Kripke suggests no longer linear time, tree-like time. So that's a description of the one particular idea how time might look like, temporal reality might look like. It's a tree-shaped. It looks a little bit like a tree, I suppose, or maybe during the winter. And not a well-drawn tree, but it's a bit like a tree. And there's an interesting story behind this Kripke prior correspondence. So let me digress. So Pryor writes back to Kripke. He says, dear Saul Kripke, I'm very grateful for your remarks and your comments. They were very helpful and fruitful. That's a very great idea that you're presenting. I believe you're going to be traveling a lot these days. So at that time, Pryor was in the United Kingdom, I believe in Manchester, and Kripke was in the US, and said that I'm certain you'll be traveling across the ocean a lot. Pryor used this nice phrase that you'll be hopping across the pond constantly. So please, whenever you are around, when you're in Britain, come and visit me in Manchester. We'll work together. And Kripke writes back, so this time the letter you had to travel by ships rather than electronic communications. A few months later, a few weeks later, Kripke returns saying that, oh, dear Professor Pryor, that's very kind of you to propose this amazing idea. However, at that moment I'm actually a high school student in Omaha, Nebraska, and only next year I'm going to be a freshman in Harvard, and I'm not certain if my professor will let me travel that much because I have to attend my courses in the first year of my study. So that was the story. So Kripke definitely made his way in the big philosophy pretty early on. So that's the end of the digression. There's no point in it. Alright, so what Kripke is doing? So it's not suggesting like a revolutionary new physical theory in a sense, or a cosmological vision. He tries to grasp a certain intuitive idea which can be exemplified by a simple story. The story actually comes from Aristotle in On Interpretation. Aristotle considered this idea of a future sea battle, which Aristotle thinks is indeterminate. It might happen, it might not happen. So let us go through this idea again. So let's say after the lecture today, I approach Piotrek and I say, okay, this conference is nearing to an end. What should we do tomorrow? I'm going to be in Lublin. What about the sea battle tomorrow? And Piotrek thinks for a while, and after a while he answers, depending on what he answers, there are two basically possible options. Either there is a sea battle tomorrow, or there is no sea battle tomorrow. So as you see here, there's a calm sea, no sea battle, and here on the right hand side there is the other option, there's a sea battle is raging, few ships are already wrecked on the bottom of the sea, so it's really bad. So that's really easy idea that really tries to grasp, and the idea was catchy, so to say. So Prior thought it is great, so he writes in next important book of his past, present and future that we may define an Occam's model, which is a kind of branching model, as a line without beginning or end, which may break up into branches as it moves from left to right, that is from past to future, though not the other way. So Prior's trees were growing rightwards rather than upwards. Even more interestingly, Kripke's trees actually were growing downwards. When he was drawing his trees, they were growing downwards. And my trees are going to be growing upwards, as they should. So then Tom Richmond Thomas summarized a paper, important, very influential paper in theory, where he writes, where, well, for many philosophical and perhaps even some scientific purposes, it is more interesting to consider the case in which time may be non-linear. Such an account of time would permit instances in which time alpha has alternative possible futures. Non-linear time puts these alternatives into the ontological structure of time. Okay, so in the ontology of time, time is non-linear. Then Burgess writes a few years later that if the determinist sees time as a line, the indeterminist sees it as a system of forking paths. So there's the idea that indeterminism should be modeled by branching of time, when determinism by a linear series. It's all very good, very exciting, very interesting, very thought-provoking. The other problem I guess I have with it is that it is false. Okay, so it is not true. Time is not branching. And they have a very, very simple-minded argument for that. So let's assume for a moment that time is actually branching. What actually means? So with this graphical representation that I used of the tree, let us say this representation of one, the ordering within this tree, which was like being below, being above. Let us assume that it actually does represent a temporal precedence relation. So what is below is before, what is above is after. So before-after relation, and then additionally, let us assume a very simple interaction principle, which I believe are very intuitive. And it should go like that. If time 1 is before time 2, then time 2 is after time 1, time 2 is in the future of time 1, and time 1 is in the past of time 2. So personally, I tend to think these are analytic truths. So, and I'm not discovering anything, but I think that's how before, after, past and future actually works. And these kind of interaction are actually built into any sort of most temporal logics, like the most basic temporal logic based on creepy structure have this interacting principle built into them. So it is quite popular. But let us then go back to our branching situation. So, if that's really before, after, it means that at this time, there are two moments after this time. One moment in which there is no sea battle, and another moment where there is a sea battle. So, given the interaction principle, we can say that it will be in the future, tomorrow, there will be a sea battle, and also in the future, that is tomorrow, there will not be a sea battle. Okay, there will be a sea battle tomorrow and there will not be a sea battle tomorrow. It is not the case that it will be both sea battle and no sea battle tomorrow. That's not true, but both conjuncts are true. And that is kind of problematic. Okay, so, and it is surprising, it would be surprising if you could get this result from a very simple observation that there are two options, there are two possibilities. There are two possible outcomes to the idea that both will happen. So it's kind of crazy. And that it was mentioned before me. So Peter Ahlstrom, in one of his early papers, writes that this idea is contrary to common usage. It is not how we talk about the future, it's not how we think about the future. that David Lewis says that this kind of idea disqualifies future-oriented attitudes. If both will happen, Lewis argues, it makes no sense to wonder what will happen. Or maybe it makes no sense to hope that there will be a sea battle, or to bet that there will not be a sea battle. These kind of attitudes are problematic if both options are going to happen. And maybe even more importantly, recently John Ehrman had a paper in which he took this idea literally, so to say, and he said that let's take it seriously. Now we're not talking about much time. These days we're talking about space-time in physics, and let us consider seriously this branching space-time model. And let's consider this model as a model of general relativity, and it turns out we run into a lot of trouble. Okay, so if you do general relativity, you really do not want your branching, your space-time to branch. So it's very, most importantly, I guess, it's very hard to guarantee how property, separation property, which is important for some reasons for general relativists. And there are many no-go results that Ehrman is giving and arguing that it's not a good idea. Branching space-time is not the way to go. And I think this argument is pretty convincing for me. I think that it would be bad for a philosopher if his idea, philosophical insight, were in conflict with physics and common sense. Okay, I think there's something wrong with it, and I guess there is a way out, actually. I have to read Kripke's quote a little bit more carefully, and he gives a suggestion what's going on here. So it is not the time of branching, so what if anything? I think something does branch, and in Kripke you can find already that in red, given the present moment, there are several possibilities for what the next moment may be like. And for each possible next moment, there are several possibilities for the next moment after that. So what is branching our possibilities? It's no longer time, it's possible scenarios or possible continuations, like some model objects which are branching. And so it's safe not to confuse these two. So what is branching is a possible ways the system can develop, something like that, or the world can develop. And until these days, people talk pretty clumsily, quite often they talk about the branching time, but actually already Richmond Thomason, who had this idea of ontologic branching built into the ontological structure of time, gives up this idea in 1984. He writes a paper on time and modality for the Handbook of Philosophical Logic. He does that work at the first paper in the handbook when he describes branching models, and then he says these tree-like frames represent ways in which things can evolve alright, so now it is not the time that branches, at least he doesn't repeat this idea. What does branch is the ways in which things can evolve. And I think it's a very, very natural idea, and it fits very well with the story that I've been giving you. So given this moment, there are two options for tomorrow. There might be a sea battle, there might be no sea battle. That is, there are two possible evolutions, the two ways in which things can evolve, battle or no battle. But then Thomason makes another step, which might be slightly more controversial, because he privileges one particular set of possibility, and his David Lewis kind of setup. So he says that still Lewis, 1917, that is ultimate actuality, and substitute the actual future for the actual world in what he says, that is the view of the thoroughgoing indeterminist. So what Lewis briefly speaking, and Thomason seems to approve of Lewis' way of doing possibilities, of doing model logic or metaphysics of modality. So Lewis is thinking, is sometimes described as an extreme realist or genuine realist about possible worlds. So he thinks that what happens around here, that means around here in our universe, so pretty big here, so what happens around here is just one of the worlds out there. So besides our universe, there are many other universes, many other universes elsewhere. Then we cannot travel to them because they are not special temporally connected with our world, but basically they are out there. And they're important for you. Is that this? If we, when we talk Lewis things, when we talk about what might happen, what possibly happens, what we actually mean is that it actually happens, in fact happens in some other of these worlds, which is elsewhere. Okay, and these guys elsewhere, then they talk what might happen, and then they say, for example, that I might be giving a talk, what they mean is that I'm giving this talk right here. So they are correct, and it is possible for them that I'm giving this talk. So it is a pretty... And now we'll need to turn to branching the ideas even more extravagant, I think. So these possible worlds actually can overlap. The Lewisian possible worlds, like for a while they go together and then they depart. So right now we are living at least in two such worlds, Lewisian worlds, in one when there will be a city battle tomorrow, and another world also in which there will not be a city battle tomorrow. For now they are glued together, but they branch in the future, and we live in both of them. And this kind of realistic attitude is somehow preserved by the writing, in the writing of Newell Bell. It's slightly more subtle than that, but he has this realistic inkling. So for example, he writes, there are three fundamental ideas: moments, the core ordering relation, and our world. First, there is the idea of a moment. A moment is an instantaneous, concrete event. The second idea is the causal ordering relation, also called the earlier-later relation. This is the B-order relation, which we postulate to be branching, rather than linear, because of indeterminism. The final idea is our world, construed as a set of moments. Okay, so what our world is like? Our world is it's made of concrete, little concrete events, which we call moments, very, very extensive events. And these events are linked together by causal relations in such a way that they form a branching structure. That is, he thinks about this, so there are two moments, there might be two moments in the structure which cannot have no causal influence at one another. And he thinks about this causal, I believe, about this causal relation in a morally loaded terms. So what it means that one, what he means by causal relation, I think, is that one event might influence the other. One is below the other, it means that one can or might or possibly influence the other. So, but basically, it is a pretty unusual way of thinking about work that is unusual for me, because basically that's how our world looks like now. It's no longer time, now it's our world. Our world is like that, and actually it's the same thing as the possibilities. So our world is really the world of possibilities. Everything that can happen is happening somewhere in our world, and every single part of our world is sort of the same kind of thing as the kind of thing that happens around here. So around here, we are at some point in our world, maybe we are here or here, but there in other place in our world, there I also live on here, for example, in which, in this other place, I'm not a philosopher, for example, I have never entered philosophy, or maybe some closer possibility, I have not been invited to the philosopher Rainy, but basically this other me, or me over there, is just as concrete a real being as me over here. Okay, so we are maybe a little bit more subtle than that, but Bellamy is careful to phrase it in a way that doesn't sound outrageous, and I think that's not an outrageous idea, but it has this realistic the idea behind. So it is the thin version of extreme realism or genuine realism. He thinks that if determined indeterminism is true and possibilities are real, our world has to be like that. So that's basically how we move from the branching of time, the branching of possibilities, to a branching world. So now we are branching in a world, we're living in a branching world, we are tree dwellers, as Belknap describes us, so let us try to do some semantics. How should we talk as tree dwellers? So there is now, finally, we face a semantic problem, which is Aristotle's semantic problem. So let's imagine there is this lady living in our world over here who says, there will be a sea battle tomorrow. And we clearly see that there are two continuations of her utterance. In one of them there is no sea battle, in the other there is a sea battle. And so what can we make of her utterance? In particular, is it true or is it false? What is she talking about? And the clear there is a problem. Like, is it true or is it false? Is it neither? Is it both? That's not an easy way of answering to this question when you just look at the picture. So it's not easy, but there are ways to answer the question. So let us now the state of the art kind of overview. There were quite a few ideas, quite a few proposals over there to how to tackle this problem. So let's begin with Bellman himself. So we meet this lady, she says that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, and we ask, is it true, is it false? And the answer of Bellman is, well, it depends. Very philosophical answer, I suppose. It depends in a sense that, yeah, it is false in the left possibility, where there's no sea battle. However, in the right possibility, where there is a sea battle, it is true. Okay, that's how things go. And I think that it can be well described as a relativism about truth in the sense of Kazimierz Twardowski. So Kazimierz Twardowski were trying to figure out whether there are any relative truths. A truth which might be thought of in a way as sentences uttered in a context or complete sentences which are true with respect to some factor and false with respect to other factor. Twardowski didn't manage to find any of these truths. And maybe Bellman has found one. When we talk about the contingent feature, we utter truths which are relative. Relatively to one possibility, they are true. Relatively to other possibilities, they are false. So, like they say, well, the answer is probably correct, but I feel, like when I first saw that, I was like, you gotta be kidding me. That's not what I'm asking. When I'm asking whether the sentence is true or false, of course it is true in the possibility when there is a sea battle and false when there is no sea battle. But that was not my question. What I wanted to tell, is it just true? Is it true simpliciter? Is it basically true? And this answer does not satisfy me somehow. Maybe you missed my point, but that was my feeling. When I first was introduced to that in a seminar with Professor Platzek, it was quite a few years back, and here I am after quite a few years asking exactly the same question. So that much about progress in philosophy. At least my personal progress in philosophy, not a very big one. So I'm asking this question, is it true simpliciter? And Bellman has an answer to that. He says, that's a stupid question to ask. When you say that we're asking whether a sentence about a contingent future is true, it basically makes no sense. It makes no sense to say that the sentence there will be a sea battle is true. It also makes no sense to say that the sentence about there will be a sea battle tomorrow is false. It's basically meaningless. You cannot understand this kind of idea. And I had a problem with that because it seems to make sense to me. Okay, I seem to know what it means that the sentence about the future is true. I think I even know what would need to happen for the sentence. I think for the sentence there will be a sea battle to be true, what would need to happen that it would be the sea battle tomorrow. Okay, and then the sentence would be true, and I have this nagging feeling. But Bellman doesn't want to go this route, and it has good features, it has a very nice logic you can generate out of it, which is Occam's logic. This idea is Occam's by Arthur Pryor, but I'm sort of dissatisfied because, as I said, this question seems to make sense to me. And furthermore, the truth of future tense sentences are arbitrary now. So whether a sentence about the future is true or false depends on completely arbitrary choice of possibility. There are no principled reasons to prefer one possibility over the other. So this sentence is true or false depending on the true or false depending on your choice. And I have this problem that I would have to develop on that, but somehow Bellman has a good way of answering that. But there is this problem that when we actually talk about the future, and we talk about the future which seems to be contingent, we heard hardly ever mention which possibility we have in mind. I say, when I go to a bookie and I say that Argentina will win the next World Cup, I do not mention quietly, of course, possibility in which Argentina is winning the next World Cup. That's the possibility I have in mind, and this sentence is true. Okay, so it's very easy to win wagers with such a semantics in mind. Not completely fair criticism, but there is this kind of feeling. So let me get back to another story, which is a very recent one. I call it Extremism. It is by Patrick. It was recently published, or maybe it's still in press, in mind, actually. So now Patrick faces the same problem, which is true, and he thinks, contrary to Bellman, that it makes sense to ask whether the sentence is true. And there is a, and this sentence says what it seems to be saying. That is, there will be a sea battle. It's true, even only if, at some moment in the future, there is a sea battle. And in some moment, in the actual and only continuation of this event, there is a sea battle. And he looks around the branching model, or maybe he thinks a little bit more about the open future, and he says, there is no future. Okay? This sentence is saying that in that future something will happen, but there is no future, or maybe there is no actual future. So, basically, he applies the Rossilian analysis of definite articles, and he has a clear answer. This sentence is false. Okay, this is false that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, because it says that in the future there will be a sea battle, but there is no the future. So it is false that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. It is also false that there will not be a sea battle, of course. It's also false that there will or will not be a sea battle tomorrow. And other weird things happen. So, for example, it is true that there will be a sea battle, even only if there will not be a sea battle. It is true that if there will be a sea battle, then I will be the king of France. It is also might happen that there is a sea battle, and still it was false to say that there would be. So it's kind of problematic. There are lots more problems. Like Patrick sort of modifies his idea to. He tries to solve some of them, but only solves a little bit of them. And I actually met Patrick when he was first developing this idea. It was, I guess, 3 years ago in Constance, and he presented to me and said, it cannot be serious. Like, you see what happens, like, this bad thing. I think you should be, I'm not certain about this idea, but he was persistent, he was pushing, and now he has a paper in mind, and who's laughing now? So I was critical at some point, and then now he might laugh in my face, and so I know what kind of lesson I can take from that. I guess even if your ideas are crazy or seem to be crazy, if you believe in them, keep pushing, you can accomplish in mind. So that's the lesson I take from that, and I'll think about applying that in the future. By the way, hi Patrick, if you listen to me, my apologies. But still, it was pretty extreme, in my opinion. So let us get back to another idea, which actually was proposed already by Arthur Pryor as an alternative to Occamism. Now, is he proposes something which I call modalism, and that is the idea that when someone says it will happen, they do not actually mean that it will happen. It's something, they mean something slightly different. There were quite a few proposals. For example, Pryor suggests that when someone says it will happen, they mean it will necessarily happen, or it will inevitably happen. So that's so-called Percianism. And then Mark Arthur, a few years later, suggests that in some reading of will just means possibly will. And recently we have heard a paper presented by Michael B. when he suggests, I don't think he published that yet, he suggests that it will actually means it probably will. When someone says it will happen, it in fact means it will probably happen. So it seems kind of alright, but it isn't. The problem is, if you take it seriously and you try to look through what happens in your logic, like pretty bad things happen in your logic. So in probabilism, sometimes things happen that were not about to happen. Just unlikely things happen. That's a kind of problem that Mike is having. But let us have a look quickly at the Percianism, which is probably the most promising line of thought. Even over there, we have pretty serious problem. For example, it is false that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, or there will be no sea battle tomorrow, which sounds almost like a tautology to me. I would be very unless it is literally the end of the world. Okay, if the end of the world, alright, it is not true that there will be sea battle tomorrow, it's also not true there will be no sea battle tomorrow, because there will be no tomorrow. But other than that, I think that it's pretty close to tautology, but it is false in Persianism. And that's other logical difficulties, they are pretty well known, already prior has described them. And I saw one attempt to defend Persianism in a paper that eventually hasn't been published, so it's not a very popular view, it's a pretty problematic, doesn't go well with the common sense. So let us look at another view, which is more promising. And I have a feeling maybe it's the best idea to go if you have the open, the branching kind of person or a tree dweller. So now when you ask a sentence, is it true that there will be sea battle, the answer is as follows. The sentence, this sentence is true, if and only if it is true in every possibility. It is false, if it's false in all possibilities, and it is neither true nor false. If it is true in some possibilities, false in other possibilities. Okay, so we have this new idea that Thomasson introduces, that some sentences lack truth values. So it's not quite Lukasiewicz's idea that some sentences have a third truth value, neutral, indeterminate, but they have no truth value whatsoever. And the sentences about the contingent future are paradigm examples of sentences which do not have truth value. And there are good sides to it. I really mean that it's pretty decent logic can be generated out of it, again, because on the bottom level it uses Occamism, so it is nice results, no weird things happening as they were happening with modalism or extremism. Now it is nice. What is kind of problematic for some, at least, that when you think about this notion of truth, then the classical connectives, such as disjunction, are not extensional anymore. So you cannot decide what the truth value of the disjunction is. You know the truth value of both the disjuncts. Sometimes it is neither true or false in the disjunction, sometimes it is true in this sense. In one sense, the rule of modus tollens is violated. So you can derive from a sentence, for example, from sentence A, you can derive that it's necessary that A, but it's not necessary that A, you cannot derive that mod A. That doesn't matter. And Timothy Williamson had some problems with supervaluations in general because of this kind of results. So, but it is still, I think there is a way of going with supervaluations, which is pretty appealing. And the last one is a recent, quite recent proposal and quite widely discussed and popular, which is relativism or assessment relativism of John McFarlane, who basically takes a little bit of modal relativism of Belknap and a little bit of supervaluationism of Thomasson and combines them together, and then he gives the following answer. If you ask yourself, is it true that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, the answer is again, the answer is, well, who's asking? Okay, and then if you tell me who's asking, I'll give you the answer. Okay, if this lady over here is asking, is it true that there will be a sea battle tomorrow? Well, for her, it is neither true nor false. However, if this lady over there is asking, is it true that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, if this sentence is true, then yeah, for her, it is false. Because it's not like that. But for this gentleman over here, it is true. The sentence is true. But depending who's asking the question, this answer, the answer differs. Okay, truly, in a true relativistic approach. Because Buckland has pretty good arguments to support that. Again, logic is nice. There are some problems which are inherited from supervaluationism, but what worries me the most is what I call the bizarre norms consequence of relativism. So what worries me the most is that sometimes, so McFarlane links the truth of a sentence with a practice of assertions. So he says that if something isn't true, we shouldn't say that. And the sentence which says that which isn't true cannot be correctly uttered. You cannot make a correct assertion with untrue sentence. And then something weird happens because, for example, this lady cannot correctly say that there will be sea battle tomorrow. She is never correct when she says that. Well, because it is contingent fact, so it's neither true nor false, so it isn't true. So she's not correct when she says that. However, if she goes wild, she knows she shouldn't say that. It's incorrect, but she does it anyway. Okay, what the heck? Maybe they will not catch me, and the punishment is not that big after all. So she says that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, and she waits one day. And let's say she gets lucky. Okay, there is a sea battle on the next day. Then, given McFarlane's proposal, she can say that, well, my utterance is perfectly correct. I was correct saying that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. I did nothing wrong. You should praise me, actually, because I said what should be said. I uttered the truthful sentence. So even though the day before we should punish her, on the next day we actually should praise her. We should, because she did a good thing. At least she didn't do a bad thing, because she said what is true, which is kind of bizarre, I think. The only way to make a true statement about the future is to violate some law in the past. You have to go against the rules so you have a chance to be correct or be good. And I will develop on that, but I have my worries. So okay, that's the end of the state of the art. That's how people were doing the semantics in the practice. The three dwellers can deal with the issue. But there is an alternative idea that I brought in. Remember that I told you that this branching picture represents possibilities. There's possible ways that the things might go. There's this extra idea, alright, there are many possible ways, alright, but only one of them happens, doesn't it? And so this is what I call actualistic intuition. Alright, many scenarios are possible, that's alright. But only one of these scenarios in fact happens. Okay, that's the extra factor that is not well incorporated into the branching setting. In the branching setting, we have all these possibilities, alright? But we don't have this extra factor that one of them in fact happens. And this intuition is pretty well phrased by George Eliot, the cosmologist, who says that things could have been different, but second by second, one specific evolutionary history out of all the possibilities is chosen, takes place, gets cast in stone. So it gets a little bit dramatic as for a cosmologist, I suppose, but it gets the intuition quite well. And people in branching world have noticed that. So I think the first two guys who noticed that were Rescher and Arkert. It's not mentioned often enough, I think, but they had this idea that something is missing. So they try to upgrade the branching idea. Okay, they say, alright, let us represent the world as an infinite tree branching toward the future. Okay, the world is branching, alright. But the actual course of history will be one among the branches of such a tree. Okay, so now the world is a branching object, but only one of the possibilities is actual. So we have this kind of picture now. The world is still branching. Okay, that's a big branching object, but only one of the parts of the world is different. Okay, this part of the world is non-actual, and this part of the world is actual. Okay, that's how it goes now. And this kind of idea was called Thin Red Line by Belknap and his collaborators, I guess by Belknap and Green initially. And so, you know, you see why it's a thin red line, because it's red and thin, and then the whole tree is thick and black. So that's how we have this thin red line idea, which is introduced by Rescher and Arkert, and it was repeated quite a few times later on. So for example, Bakim and Davis have this idea in 1976, Brauner and his collaborators in 2000, Ostrom in 2009. So it keeps coming back. I call it halfway actualism. So there's a model world, and within this world, one part of the world is different. But if you go this way, this matrix is easy again. You don't have to struggle that hard. You know what to do, so to say, when you see the sentence which talks about the future. So, well, the sentence, there will be a sea battle tomorrow, is true, even only if, in fact, there will be a sea battle tomorrow. And it is false if, in fact, there will not be a sea battle tomorrow, which I think is as it should be. I have this feeling, and now they have resources in the model to capture this idea. Okay, I'm just uttering the sentence here, the movie is Siva tomorrow. Well, in the battle will happen. Alright, and this thing happens. Okay, good. So it's false. Okay, this sentence is false because it says that it will happen, but it doesn't happen. So it's semantics is easy again, but it turns out that the idea is pretty problematic. And Belknap was quick to point it out, and he says there are problems with metaphysics, problems with epistemology, actually also problems with actuality, surprisingly, and also logical problems, which I will not mention today. So let us go through these problems briefly, but most of the problems, I believe, are based on a similar initial idea. Okay, you say that only one of the parts of the world is special, that's the actual part of the world. But what about this guy, poor guy who lives over here? He's not an actual guy. He's living here in our world, he's happy with his family and his wife, and now he's not actual. Isn't it cruel? Or is it something we're doing wrong to him? So that's the base of the many problems of Belknap, as I see them. And I think they're right, actually. I don't think we should... But I'll get back to that. So, problem with physics. Okay? Belknap asks, what in the structure of our world could determine a single possibility from among all the others to be actual? And it is hard to find such a thing. You look at our world, and what in this big branching object, and what in this world privileges one of these possibilities? Like, there's hard to find such a property. All over there are real people, concrete people, living their lives. They think they're actual, as we do think that we are actual, and they, physically speaking, there's no special property that privileges these possibilities over the others. It seems like kind of dogma that we are introducing to our story, that there's one part of the world is different. There's hard to find anything to base this idea in. But there's another problem of actuality. Belknap says this, that this theory has also troubles with actuality. This world, being the actual world, does not favor it over any others, but it is just a reflection of the fact that this is the world at which we are conversing. Which is an afterthought from David Lewis, from Anselm and Actuality, actually, when Lewis writes, the ontological argument who says that his world is special because his world alone is the actual world, is as foolish as a man who boasts that he has the special fortune to be alive at a unique moment in history, the present. Okay, so both of them have this idea of actuality is not like a real property, which ascribes to some object in the world, is the indexical property. What is actual depends who's talking, and for us we are actual, for this other guy elsewhere he's actual, and we are all right in a sense, because there's no absolute actuality. And this idea seemed to introduce the absolute actuality, because this guy, he thinks he's actual, and when he says that he's actual, he's actually mistaken. Which leads us to the next problem, which is a problem with epistemology. It's a very brief one. How we could know whether we are actual? How could we find out? And it's the same question to ask, actually, within this setting. There are so many possibilities in our world. Our world is made of so many possibilities. It's so extremely unlikely that we are still actual. That it's hard to believe that we are living in the actual world. Most likely in the actual world, in the actual course of history, there are still dinosaurs running around the earth, and we are merely possible. Okay? We are not living in the actual world, we are living in the only possible world, even though it seems actual to us, but we really are not actual, because some other part of the world is the actual part of the world, and it's hard, like it looks stupid, doesn't it? And because this problem looks stupid, it suggests that the initial idea was stupid, that only one part of the world is actual and other parts of the world are not actual. So Belknap says, let's give up with this idea of actuality altogether, let's get back to our ordinary tree-like world, and we're gonna be alright. And I hope to go against this, I hope I can present an alternative to this move that Belknap suggests. So I want to get actuality straight. I think there is something confused with this previous idea of halfway actualism. And I think that there was one step that was implicitly made, which we do not have to make. And there is something like that. Okay, that according to Brentian realism, realists, when you realize that the world is indeterministic, there are many possibilities, you should conclude that the world itself is a branching object, or concrete reality branches, because otherwise you wouldn't be a determinist. So what happens right here is only one of the possibilities, but elsewhere in our world there are other possibilities like that. Could you possibly open the door? Maybe you have some breeze in here. It's going to be a little bit better. I didn't expect that. Please the door again. Close the door again. There's some danger in this group. I didn't predict. Okay, so but now. So Brentian realists convince us that the world is branching, but I don't think you need to go this way. Unfortunately, I'm not the only one, right? There's important people who said that before me, among them Robert Stalnaker, who said it pretty well, that, well, one could accept this is one, that there are many ways things could have been, while denying that there exists anything else that is like the actual world. Okay, so he says that there is no direct move from accepting possibility to accepting that all the possibilities are equally real, so to say. All the possibilities are like what happens around us. You can believe that there are many possibilities without believing that all the possibilities are ontologically of the same nature, so to say, as our world. And I think that is another way of putting this Ellis idea. Remember what Ellis says, that things could have been different second by second. One specific evolutionary history out of all possibilities is chosen, takes place, and gets cast in stone. That's the kind of idea I try to follow. The kind of idea I try to follow. And I draw pictures because I am a little bit childish in my philosophy. I have this feeling that if I cannot draw something, I cannot understand it. So I always try to draw my ideas of my opponents. So now I have another drawing. So let's try to draw the really actualistic perspective on branching. So let's begin with a maybe slightly simplified model in which there is the first moment in time. So there's this big bang, the world begins. Okay? And at time zero, the world is in one specific state. That's the world at time zero. That's the big bang, not that big. Actually, that's the beginning of the world. And then, it all began. And then I have the feeling, now we want the possibilities. If the world is not deterministic, it might develop many ways. I think these possibilities are somehow inherently present already at the state of the world in its initial state. So you somehow can generate, well, how can the world can possibly go on given in what state it is initially. Okay, and how you do that, I'm not sure how you do that. Maybe you can do what Professor Chakrabarty is doing, and you talk that in the initial state of the world has certain causal powers, and has dispositions and propensities to go this way or that way, and out of this combination of propensities and dispositions, you can draw all the possibilities. Maybe you prefer to go with something like nomological necessity, and you say that, given the state of the world at time zero and how the laws of nature actually are, these are the possible outcomes, the possible ways that things can develop in our world, given how the laws of nature are and how the state of the world actually is. Okay, so we have the possibility. So the world has its paths of these possibilities set, but then it starts growing, or maybe time after time, as Alice said, one specifically is the possibility is chosen, that is one specific thing actually happens. So after the beginning, at later time, something different happens, and as it happens, it realizes one of the possibilities. Once the possibility is chosen, and this arrow says it's actualization or realization. So the world, at moment after moment after moment, one exact and unique thing is happening in our world, but it is the thing that is chosen from the possible options. So later on, the world's over here. Now it's an interesting point, because the world has two options, so to say, at this time. It can develop this way or that way, but we know that in fact only one of these things happen. So one has to happen, so let's say this one happens. So the world chooses this route and keeps growing, so maybe new things are happening, different things are happening at different times, then still some unique thing is happening and the one exact possibility is being actualized. So that's alternative picture. Alright, the world is not branching. The world is that's what I mean when I say the set actuality is straight. Okay, actuality used to be crooked like that, now it is straight. And as the world goes on, one exact possibility is being chosen, one exact possibility is actualized. That's how the world works. Okay? So that's alternative idea. There is determinism, alright? There is branching, there are many possibilities, but as the time goes on, only one exact possibility is being chosen. So let us see how this metaphysical idea that I'm sketching might influence our semantics. So going back to realism for a second, so this branching realism. So we are here in the branching realism world, and the lady says that there will be a sea bath tomorrow. What will it make of it? And Belknap makes this interesting comment. Well, our moment, the context of this communication, that is what happens around here, is part of many possible histories, all of which are equally marked as ours. Okay, so this act of speech is happening in many possible scenarios, all of equally ours. Or MacFarlane repeats a similar kind of story. Well, consider a concrete case in which a sentence is used. There will be many worlds that diverge only on the future history. The concrete episode of use takes place in all of them. So this concrete episode of speech happens in many possibilities, in many worlds, in many possible worlds, and it is very hard to privilege any one of them, so we have to go around and invent some nice semantics to deal with this issue. But when you are in the... Okay, before we get to the actualistic world. So what I think people got confused a little bit. Okay, so we are drawing the simple picture of possibilities, that's how branching is usually introduced. We draw a few possibilities, then we draw a moment T, and we draw a sentence which says there will be a sea battle tomorrow, and then we ask, is the sentence uttered at this possible moment true? Okay, and then we have a problem, because this utterance is a part of many different worlds. This sentence is uttered in many worlds, there's no reason to choose any one of them. So we face a problem, we have to deal with it somehow. So what I believe where the problem is actually in the first point. So there is a little bit of confusion, I believe, because I argued initially that this branching picture represents possibilities, how the world can possibly develop in possible evolution of the world. So in fact, what's here, it's a possible utterance. Okay? And possible utterances are possibly true and possibly false. And this possible utterance is possibly true and possibly false, but we seem to be asking different questions. We ask whether this possible utterance in the tree of possibilities is actually true. Is this possible utterance true, or is it in fact true? And then we face a problem, and we are drawn towards this realistic picture. Because we thought about these three as possibilities, but then we think about concrete actual act of others having in those possibilities. So we think that possibilities are concrete, are concrete structures. And I think this was misleading. I think this is just what commits us to a particular way of looking at the matter. The decisive movement in the conjuring trick has been made, and it was the very one that we thought quite innocent. Okay, so I agree with Wittgenstein here that philosophers sort of made the problem of them by themselves. So they asked the wrong kind of question, and it generated a problem, and then they spent a few decades solving this problem. Okay, and I'm a therapist that come to philosophers and have to heal them by showing them the question was ill posed and there is really no big problem. So that's my attempt here. And I say, so let us look at this question again, but from the actualistic perspective. Not it looks like that. Looks like that.
The utterance is not being made here. Okay? It is only a possible scenario, which maybe is the set of propositions. Or maybe it's the somehow structure of dispositions. Like, these are not the kinds of things where people live and ask questions. People live over here. People talk over here in the real world. And in the real world, this lady says that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. And now, we kind of, it's much easier to privilege one of the possibilities. And we don't want that to happen. So this lady says that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. Let's see what happens. All right? There is no sea battle tomorrow. So the lady was wrong. And that's the end of it. The utterance doesn't happen. In many possibilities, it happens in one world only, and this one world actualizes only one of the possibilities. And when you look at this picture like that, the semantics is very easy again. So we repeat this semantic claim that the sentence is true if and only if in fact there will be a sea battle tomorrow, false if in fact there will not be. So there is utterance, there will be a sea battle tomorrow, but at a later moment, there is no sea battle tomorrow, so this utterance is false. And formally speaking, you can basically encode this intuition with a very simple observation that if you want to know if a sentence is true in a context, just ask yourself, is it true in the moment of the context, in the world of the context? So in the end of the day, I get back to very basic Kaplanian idea how to think about these issues, which was very much challenged in the branching setting. They said there's nothing like the world of the context, and I think there is the world of the context. That's the world of the context which actualizes this possibility. So this sentence uttered here is true if it is true in this possibility at this moment. Okay? I still evaluate the sentence actually uttered in this structure of possibilities because the actual sentence might talk about possible scenarios. So I can actually say, instead that there will be a sea battle, I can actually say there might be a sea battle, there might not be a sea battle. I can say the fact that it might not have come here. And to evaluate sentence like that, I'm gonna need these other possibilities. Is it true that it's possible that there's a sea battle? Well, yeah, there is another possibility, which is not actualized in the end of the day, but it is out there. And so that's you can the way to go, or the way one can go, I believe. And we have pretty nice advantages for money speaking. So we have non-relative truth values, sentences are either true or false, and these truth values are grounded in facts. So whether the sentence is true depends on what in fact happens. You have classical logic, including bivalence. You have nice interaction of time and modality. Again, you have an Occam's logic. You have pretty decent semantics for this index, but what an index actually. So I think there are reasons to go along this way. And the last thing I will try to do is to face the problems that Belknap has proposed. So Belknap said, well, this idea of actuality is misguided because all of these healthy problems of metaphysics and epistemology. And we have seen that these problems were real ones. In the previous, in the thin red line picture, these were real problems. Let's see if they are still that real. So the Belknap asks, what in the structure of our world could determine a single possibility from among all the others to be actual? And it's a good question to ask in this branching world. However, if you're not living in the branching world, you're living in the world like that, in which one thing happens at a time, so to say, then you have a pretty nice, you see what in the structure of our world determines one possibility over the others. What determines one possibility is what actually happens. Okay? In our world, one thing happens at a time, and as it happens, it chooses one of the possibilities, and that's how the human possibilities are being determined. So this is kind of Aristotelian idea that there are many potential, but only one act. Okay, so what determines this possibility is the structure of the world itself. The world is linear, so it has to choose only one of the possibilities, but it shouldn't suggest determinism. Okay, so no possibility is necessarily chosen. Oh, sorry.
So no possibility is necessarily chosen. Like, the world can go whichever way it wants. The world can go this way, can go this way, can go this way, but in fact it does go one way rather than the other. In our case, it goes this way. And so no possibility, for no possibility it's necessary that it's going to happen. But it is necessary that one possibility is going to happen. Okay, so one, it is necessary that only one of possibilities is going to be actualized, but non single possibility is necessarily actualized. So it's not a deterministic picture. The problem of actuality, again, Bellner thinks that this world being the actual world does not favor it over any others, but it is just a reflection on the fact that this is the world in which we are conversing. I kind of agree with that. I think that this world being actual does not favor it over any others because there are no others. Okay, so there are no other worlds like our world in which people are conversing. We are the only people who are conversing. And as we do, we are talking about our world and what is possible in our world, in our linear world. And if the problem is the indexical treatment of actuality that Bellner is suggesting, that actuality should be an indexical, a model indexical, you can do indexical semantics of actuality without being realist. We are being model realist, and Stalnaker showed us the way. And finally, how could we know whether we are actual? How could we find out? So it was problematic previously, because this guy over here didn't know if he's actual or not. He thought he was actual, but actually he wasn't. Because this lady over here was actual. And now this problem doesn't appear, because if you ask yourself if you're actual, you're doing it somewhere over here. And you're living in our world and I wonder, am I actual or not? And you're guaranteed to be correct. Okay, guaranteed, when you think that you're actual, you be safe. You are actual because you're living in this world, you're asking yourself this question in our world, so whenever you ask yourself a question, you're guaranteed that the answer is affirmative. Yes, I am actual. And that's an interesting case, actually, of a sort of contingent a priori truth of Saul Kripke. So you can know a priori, whenever you ask yourself whether you're actual, it's true, yes, you are actual, but still it's not necessary. It is contingent, you might not have been actual. Okay, if there was a possibility in which that we wouldn't be here, but still, it's very easy to find out whether we are actual. We are guaranteed, we a priori know that we are actual, that's how the world works, so to say. So I think I have a way, at least, to answer Bellner's problem, and I think that he still can believe in actuality within the branching setting. And at this point, let me finish my presentation. And thank you very much for your extended.
Thank you very much, Jacek, and I'm opening the discussion, which we have.
Okay, let's start. I really enjoyed the talk. It's really great. But one thing that really concerns me about your theory, if I got it correctly, the whole point of making this Russian point was to somehow capture the idea that the future is not determined at this moment, so that we can, that, well, it isn't the case that, it would, that there will be, neither is the case that there will be a sea battle, nor is the case that we won. Neither of these two sentences is strictly true. This was the original idea, say, of the Russian version. That, you know, if I get it correct, maybe I'm totally wrong to some point of your theory, but it seems to me that if you just say that, well, we pick one branch that is actually happening, the history that means one fall cut in stone, then what are, like, say, predictions on sentences on true values of sentences that differentiates this theory, discriminates it from, you know, simple-minded determinism. There is simply only one feature. What are the predictions? What is the sentence that's different? What do these do?
Exactly.
Do they model sentences? Or?
Right. Thank you very much. That's an excellent question, and it's indeed how Kasiewicz framed the debate. So it's kind of hard for me to argue from this kind of theory in Poland. Okay, Polish people did read Łukasiewicz and did learn the lesson, and they speak I'm crazy straight away. Mm-hmm. And so it's particularly hard. Abroad is a little bit easier. Still, but when you actually look into Aristotle, who poses this problem first of all, when he talks about the open future, he doesn't talk about these sentences being neither true nor false, as Łukasiewicz does. That the future is open, it means that neither true nor false that there will be a city battle tomorrow. What Aristotle does, he says that the future is open, it means it might happen and that might happen. That is the both options are possible. There are more than one possibility. That's how the, so he phrases openness of the future or indeterminism in modal terms. So it's not settled that one thing will happen, it's not necessary that one thing will happen, it's possible that many different things might happen. That's how Aristotle puts it, and I think that how we should put it. Okay? If you don't do that, like, it's very easy to disqualify my theory if you, by definition, say that the world is deterministic if sentences about the future have truth values. And then I say that sentences about the future do have truth values, ergo, or the deterministic, ergo contradiction, because I said it's indeterministic. Okay, so that's problematic. So I think that the safer way of putting these things would be world is deterministic if one development is necessary. Okay, and if you put it that way, that's exactly as you suggested, that the way to answer the what distinguishes deterministic setting from indeterministic setting within the level of language. Okay, you're guaranteed that it is true that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, or it is true that there will not be a sea battle tomorrow, because one thing is going to happen, and I think actually that is what Aristotle says. But what he distinctly differentiates this idea, this setting, is that in this place, it is true that it is possible that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, and also it is true that it is possible that there will not be a sea battle tomorrow, while in the indeterministic setting, it is not so. Only one of these is possible.
So, is there anything specific to, well, to tense or to this time operators, or is it simply modal? Is there anything specific to the fact that you are talking about possibilities in the future, or is it exactly the same thing that you are talking about the possibilities of the past?
That's tricky. Actually, this possibility operator is supposed to be time dependent in a sense. So, what is possible depends on what happens. Given this state of the game, what the game might be like. And if you go like that, then usually people have this feeling that given this state of the world, the previous states of the world are necessary. You cannot change the game backwards, so to say. You cannot influence the past. And so in this sense, that would make the asymmetry between the future and the past. So not the fact that sentences about the future are not true, and sentences about the past are true. What makes the difference that about the past there's only one possibility, but about the future there are many possibilities. But strictly speaking, the model operator simply quantifies all the history, so it doesn't literally take this temporal aspect into account.
Okay, so maybe that is it.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. I had a question on
let me think about it.
So first of all, thank you very much for this interesting talk, and I have a ton of questions about all these theories that you presented.
Only one.
But I will restrict myself to one. Well,
we can talk after one.
One thing that is really troubling me is that the way the setting is described.
Right.
We say that we treat this, there will be a sea battle tomorrow, as a description of a future state. But actually, uttering these sentences, we make a prognosis. Mm. And I really think that we should think about what are we uttering here when we make a prognosis. Yeah. We are not describing some future state of affairs. We are rather describing the current state of affairs with our imagined impact on future state of affairs. So we're actually not describing a future state of affairs here. We're saying, well, there's a sea level tomorrow. This means I predict, I say this, there will be a sea level tomorrow because I see the ships lining up, I heard somebody say, so I'm actually describing the current state of affairs in order to
give a, for all I know, there will be a
battle. Yeah, like in order to give a prognosis on the future. So these prognoses, they have quite other quality criteria than the description.
Of
current state of affairs, like this is a chair. Well, I can give you like, because you know, I see there's a chair, you all see there's a chair, etc., etc. We can have this correspondence description relation, but for prognosis.
I see.
You know what I mean? Like,
I know perfectly well what you mean. And it actually does, this kind of insight that you are mentioning, kind of draw people into this kind of modalistic attitude to the future, about the future that I have mentioned, or maybe to the evaluation of the idea. That is, as you said, it is true that there will be a sea battle. I say that only because I see that the causes already in here, okay? Already in there, the sea battle kind of is existing in its causes. So what I really mean is that it is necessary that there will be, or highly likely, for something like that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. If that's okay, so then let me carry on, and maybe you, if that's wrong conjecture, I'll carry on. So if that's not the case, then you ask yourself, what are the... Let's look at the speech act of prognosis. When such an act is accurate, and when it's fortunate, or when it's unfortunate. And routinely speaking, when someone makes a prognosis, we require from this person to know what she's talking about. Okay, we don't make wild prognosis usually about the future, and the better the expert is, the better the ground we expect from this expert. And I think that when you look at the different speech acts about the future, such as prognosis, or easily getting a strong one, prediction may be slightly weaker, then you have like a conjecture about the future. Maybe in the end of the day you have a guess. I guess that there will be a sea battle tomorrow. If you guess that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, you don't have that strong requirement anymore. So there is this difference of what you are required to know, what you are required to, the state in which, the position in which you are required to be to utter a sentence, which if it is to be a prognosis. And I think that it should be taken into account, but I think that it should be taken into account on the level of pragmatics, if you can distinguish these two. So it's going to be the speech act theory should deal with these kind of things. When is it correct? When you're entitled to make a prognosis, but whether the prognosis is true or false is independent of whether you are in a appropriate state of mind or a appropriate state of knowledge or something.
I would just say, like, truth or false is not at place here. There will be like successful or non-successful. It's like, so when I'm saying tomorrow there will be sea devil, I'm just giving a short, it's like a shorter way of speaking to say, oh, I see these ships lining up, I heard their leader to say that there will be, and that they pledge to protect them, and maybe you can express this in likeliness as well. I'm just saying, like, we're not talking about future state of affairs in the mode of describing. We're describing current state of affairs. And it's just a shorter way of expressing all these like sentences that maybe we do have this prognosis. So we're actually not talking about future state of affairs.
Alright. I tend to disagree, but we can talk a little bit more after.
Okay,
thank you very much. Yeah, I have one question which probably is slightly similar to the one by Bach. Namely, what exactly you mean by the law of the contracts? My initial intuition is that if you introduce the law of the context to conditions as you can see now on the slide,
right,
then in a certain sense you are really already having a certain history that is sometimes built out or chosen, right? So
that's right, but I see, okay, go.
Yes, so in a certain sense, if this is your proposal, then in a certain sense you are just pretending that you are not working within determinism, because you are in a certain sense presupposing some kind of determinism here.
Okay.
By saying that, because the law of the context seems to be just chosen
All right.
Here.
I see that you have read your Łukasiewicz and Kotarbiński as well, which is not surprising even that you're from Warsaw. So I see the point, and I think there is a point to be explained away in a sense, in this insight or this intuition of drawing us into this view. So somehow the idea in here is that already this context, and within this context, the whole of these possibilities contained somehow. Already within this moment of the utterance, somehow I have this single unique possibility that will happen in here. Okay, so in a sense, nothing else can happen because already here I have chosen one and only one possibility. So now we are determinist, even though. All right. So I think that's not how the world of the context. Okay, the world of the context is not picked on the basis of what's already present here and now. So if you know especially when you have temporal operators, what will happen in the future, what will happen in the past, if you want to, the world of the context is picked depending on what will in fact happen. Okay, so what is the world of the context here on FC depends on what will happen after C. So if after C, this thing will happen, then that's the world of the context. But if after C, then C bubble happens, then that will be the world of the context. So the world of the context is, so I think that's a question of grounding. In a sense, the question of how the truth, how important you think truth is. So I think the truth is very unimportant. And other people might think that the truth is very important. Okay, so the idea kind of, here, I guess which is related to that, but I didn't have time or opportunity to talk about here, is whether you can ground, you can have truth makers of sentences which are uttered here elsewhere, or whether how strong impact of the truth is. If it is true here that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, does it? It seems that some people have this feeling, as Łukasiewicz, that it makes it necessary that there will be sea battle tomorrow. The truth of the sea battle tomorrow makes the sea battle tomorrow. That's the idea. The sentence being true here somehow produces future sea battle. And have it the reverse intuition. This sentence is being true only because the sea battle actually happens later on. So the truth supervenes on what in fact happens. So sort of truth have to follow the world. The world doesn't have to follow the truth. That's the idea. So the dependence is one way only, or the grounding is one way only. The truth is grounded in facts, but facts are not grounded in truth. So if something is true, it doesn't. And in this case, if we do semantics, which world is the world of the context is grounded in what in fact happens. So that's a longer story that have to be told.
The tiny one. Do you care at all about the notion of disagreement?
Ask me a question, I'll there if I can.
I wonder if somebody says this
lady
at point C, moment C, she's saying, there will be a sea battle tomorrow, and there is a different person who says there won't be a sea battle tomorrow. At the moment of utterance, are they disagreeing?
I mean, they are definitely, it doesn't disagree.
But this is some sort of gradual, residual disagreement that gets resolved only once,
of course, that's true. That is, you cannot
finally
resolve this argument before we see what actually happened. You have a preliminary run, so to say. So if two people are arguing and one is saying that, well, I see this, sheep that are lying in the harbor, and captains already made their decisions, and I know all these facts. This person seemed to be winning in this argument about whether there will be a sea battle tomorrow. So okay, they are in a better position. Usually, quite often, we would already say, okay, this person won the argument. But even if this person has very good arguments to say that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, these two people are arguing, but later on, the sea battle doesn't in fact happen. Because of some weird accident, it would be very weird to say for me that the first person was right. The person who said that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, who had very good arguments for that. But in fact, there was no sea battle on the next day because of some chancy event. It would be very peculiar for me to say that this person, in the end of the day, was correct in this argument, and the person who said that there will not be a sea battle tomorrow was incorrect.
Okay.
Yes, in a sense it wasn't correct because they didn't have good grounds for the
claim. But did I get it right that there are, I mean, the two conditions for the sentence at the moment were like, it is true that it's possible that there will be a survival tomorrow,
right.
And it is possible that there will not be a survival
tomorrow.
So obviously, I mean, if you look at it this way, these two people are hardly disagreeing.
Excuse me?
They are hardly disagreeing with people at the moment.
Oh, yeah, they are in agreement about what is possible.
Yeah.
That's like a precondition of the disagreement. So initially they agree that all, both options are possible, and then they start arguing, but what did in fact happen?
Okay.
Okay, so I do this kind of stuff with people sometimes, so I have a feeling that we're arguing, but we grant that okay, the exam might be on the 12th, and maybe that's not a good example, but we have the two options. What the outcome of the game might be like, but still we're arguing pretty hard about who will win.
Okay.
You never would say you describe the future state different than the other one in those arguments.
I suppose the description of the future is a peculiar way of phrasing this thing.
Yeah.
Right, that's right.
Okay.
That's right. I think the speech act of describing hardly applies to the future, I suppose.
Right.
I would have to think that a little bit longer about it, but thanks, that's a good point. Maybe that makes a difference in terms of the speech act attitude that we have towards the past and for the future.
I think that is a
good point. I like your ideas of going away from the model realism, pretty much, I just find this a model realism and but I'm worried about the future because it seems that you said that
we all are.
are grounded in future events, while I
right.
think that there are no future events. There will be people, but they are not dead. There are no people.
Of course,
future,
of course.
So
that's true.
No
that's definitely true.
And it just develops. And if I look at your picture, it's, you can say, okay, now it's summer in Italy, and there's a difference between past and future.
In the modern terms,
but not in the words, in the
time,
and
yeah.
For me, indeterminism is the thesis
okay.
that there is no.
I see your point.
It's
yes,
not
yes, existing. Right, right. And I try to avoid this trap. Okay, I try to distance myself from the claim that the future exists. That would be kind of a crazy claim to make. That already now the future exists. I know. I think it's like a contradiction in terms. Okay. The future is the stuff that will happen, and it's weird to say that what will happen in the future happens now. That would be a very weird thing to say, and I don't want to say that. So,
no, but
I think
it's more serious. So, if you characterize indeterminism and the future in terms of model terms, if I look at the picture,
right.
the one that's the couple of branches, I see absolutely no difference between past and future events. They all have possible, everything is possible on the game that sense of possibility. And was possible and will be possible.
Okay.
There is not a asymmetry in terms of modal characteristics. I mean, you said that they is, but
right.
I don't see it because if you look at the past, there are still two possibilities.
Okay, that's right, that's right. So look, it was possible. In this sense, it was possible that I wouldn't come here. Okay? But given I did come here, it is settled that I did. Okay? That makes a difference. And it is not settled that I will ever leave Lublin. Okay? Lublin is a dangerous place, many things might happen. So that's how I distinguish the model terms in the future. It is settled that I did come to Lublin, but it is not settled that I will leave Lublin. Okay? There is this asymmetry in these terms. But about them, I try to get back to this realistic idea. So I think there is something in Greek. I think that lies at the bottom of Łukasiewicz's question. Łukasiewicz in attitude towards the future, and the attitude that also Arthur Pryor was sharing, and Kotarbiński to extend, and Charles Sanders Peirce. There were smart people who thought this way. There were smart people who thought otherwise as well. But I tried to figure out what these smart people had in mind. So what I is say that somehow the context C, if I say that there will be a C battle tomorrow, this feature is already laid out. The feature is already out there, it's somehow P. And then already in the present. For it to be true in the present, the future somehow have to be inherently existing in the present as well. And if it inherently exists already in the present, and the present is somehow settled, the future is also somehow settled. I think that's the kind of insight that I try to develop out of this idea. And I think that disagreement, in the end of the day, is not initially at all as you just said, but this disagreement is metaphysical in spirit. On the one hand, there are people who are block universe, or B-theorists, eternalists, different names for that. But on the other hand, there are people who are presentists, block universe, growing block kind of people, and they does the disagreement. But now I tend to think that the disagreement is semantic in nature. So when I say that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, the question is, can I, at the face value, I do not need to say that there's anything in the present that makes it true that there will be a sea battle tomorrow, because the sentence doesn't say that presently the future sea battle exists. The sentence, literally speaking, says that tomorrow there will be a sea battle, so all is necessary is that there will be tomorrow, and tomorrow there will be a sea battle. Okay, if that's the case, then the sentence is true. I don't need the sea battle sort of pre-exist in its causes already here, because the sentence doesn't say that already now somehow the future is already present. It says that there will be some future. I don't say that there is future. Okay, at least I don't need to say that the future exists. I can say that the future will exist, and when it does, something will happen in this future. So, in fact, in particular, when tomorrow will come, something will happen, and either there will be a sea battle when it comes, tomorrow comes, or there won't be a sea battle tomorrow. And depending what happens when the future comes, it is what makes the sentence about the future true or false. Because that's what they are talking about. They are talking about what will happen when the future comes. So I try to avoid this pull towards finding truth makers of the future tense claims already in the present, and so which kind of generate this idea that there's the future is already existing here. But I think it's a semantic decision at the end of the day whether truth claims at one moment can be grounded in what happens at another moment.
We must stop.
Okay, but they will.
If you ask any question, we won't leave this room today, and dinner will happen soon. So thank you very much.